I welcome you all for this wider contextual biblical hermeneutics jointly organized by the Church of South India and the Ecumenical Christian Center. Friends, this evening we have an amazing scholar by name Dr. Jayasri KB. Dr. Jayasri KB has completed her doctorate in theology in the New Testament studies under the Senate of Serampore College. She is also a founder president of Amazing Grace Ministries India. Dr. Jayasri KB is also a professor of the New Testament studies. She is also author of essays on post-colonial reading of Luke, philanthropic mission of Jesus, feminist spirituality, women and reformation, and other. Today she'll be presenting a fascinating topic, an interesting topic on Pentecost, mission of the early church in Acts. Dr. Jayasri KB, ma'am, we are so much delighted to have you with us. Thank you so much for accepting our invitation. I give this time to the scholar, Dr. Jayasri KB. Over to you, ma'am.
Praise Lord and good evening to all of you. Greetings to you all in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's with immense joy that I'm seated here today for the presentation. First of all, I express my heartfelt thanks to my God who has led me thus far by his amazing grace. I cannot forget the contributions of my students and my teachers in different levels, in different times. To select me and to be part of you, it's because of Johnson, sir. I express my thanks to Johnson, sir, for inviting me as well as allowing me to be part of this program. I also appreciate and thank CSI as well as CCCI for every endeavors that they undertake, keeping up such a great mission in mind and practicing theology from the very grassroots level. I also would like to express my thanks to the moderator who graciously introduced me with kind words. I invite all of you, as well as I thank all my friends, my teachers, and my students, those who are present today. And I'm very much delighted this evening, long awaited day for some of my students and even for me. And especially program as this, a lecture just by one person is not so significant. But as students, those who have enrolled into this course, I have said many times to my friends and my friends that this is such a wonderful opportunity that you got. Exposing text, interpreting the text, dealing the text with all the hermeneutical tools from different levels by the scholars from different places. And I really appreciate this task undertaken. And most of its thanks must go to, again, Johnson, sir. And I always appreciate him and all those who work behind this. And I also thank God for the scholars who have presented the bar and the right to present. You are enlightening us, including me. And this day, it's my pleasure, my happiness, my joy to present myself and be with the program and give the lecture. We know the present time and crisis of this time. In a context of this, we have so as the best classes set, we do have other classroom like Google and other. But you also know many of us may have the problem with the bandwidth. So I have recorded my lecture and will be playing the recorded video. At the end of it, again, we have the time for discussion. Not taking too much of time again for the introduction, thanking one and all, appreciating all of you for your participation, for your involvement in these classes. And now we begin the lecture.
The title for our presentation is The Pentecost and the Mission of the Early Church in the Book of Acts. The Pentecost and the Mission of the Early Church in the Book of Acts. The Book of Acts, or the Acts of Apostles, is also known as Acts of the Holy Spirit. The Book of Acts is the sequel to the third gospel and forms the essential link between the Gospel of Luke, which gives the account of Jesus Christ, and in Book of Acts, we have the accounts of the beginning of the church. The Book of Acts is the chief source of information on the Pentecost mission in the early church and the expansion of Christianity from Jerusalem to the end of the earth. The first thing we discuss about Acts and mission. Acts and mission. God is the God of mission. Mission is rooted in the very nature and character and attributes of God. It is God's own task. It belongs to God as it originated from God. Therefore, mission is everything the church is sent to do in the world. It is the mission of God given to the church through Jesus Christ. It is necessary to the very existence and life of the church on earth. Historically, the mission of the early church began on the day of Pentecost. Even though in the midst of severe persecutions, the apostles strived for the fast growth of the early church and stood as strong witnesses of Jesus Christ. The word mission is derived from the Latin root misso. It refers to the missio Dei, which means the divine necessity or the necessity of God's mission. The verb form of mission is metere or mito, meaning to send or I sent. The concept of mission found in the Greek New Testament is apostolos, meaning sent one, or apostolo means being sent. Generally, it is understood as the whole task, endeavor, and program of the Church of Jesus Christ to reach out across cultural, geographical, or throughout cultural boundaries of the Mediterranean world to the end of the world by sending missionaries to evangelize the people. It is the process by which a community of people of God is formed from all the peoples of the earth. In fact, it is designed to meet the needs of the humanity, to heal, to be healed, to comfort and to be comforted, to reconcile and to be reconciled, liberate and to bring justice and humanize the people. Mission is God turning to the world in respect of creation, care, redemption, and consummation. It is God's activity that reaches out to His world through Jesus Christ and His Spirit. Therefore, it is the divine activity springing directly from God's own nature. Lastly, it is the continuation of Christ's mission on earth and based on the great commission of our risen Lord. As we find in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. It is the kingdom movement with twofold plans: the making of disciples and the development of Christians. Mission is the program of the Church of Jesus, reaching out to the cross-cultural geographical boundaries of the world. And the next thing that we have to see is Pentecost and mission. At the Pentecost event, the apostles spoke in the languages of various nations present in the day of Pentecost in Jerusalem. Luke's purpose of lifting the people representing their nations was to show that people were really represented among the Jews who made the audience at Pentecost. The crowd that was assembled in Jerusalem represented every nation under heaven. Pentecost was the event and a turning point for the entire missionary spread of the gospel, beginning from Jerusalem, the day of Pentecost, to the uttermost part of the earth. The history of the expansion of Christianity will merely be a logical consequence of the universal orientation that the Church received from the Holy Spirit in the very first day of Pentecost. From Pentecost onward, the Church becomes obedient to the Great Commission. During the time of Christ, the spread of the gospel was focused to the house of Israel. And consequently, most of the events occurred in Judea and Galilee. In Acts, however, the commission was to minister to the scattered Israel and to spread gospel throughout the Roman Empire and beyond. The expansion was not without its difficulties. Long, dangerous travels, persecutions, issues of the church policy, incorporation of the foreigners, maintaining distinct congregational challenges. But the apostles sought to fulfill the Great Commission by carrying out the gospel to the nations. There is no evidence that the disciples attempted to carry out the commission prior to the Pentecost. The execution of the Great Commission is the central task of the Church. For by means it is the Spirit that transmits to man the life that shall make possible the recognition of the Lordship of Jesus Christ. The progression of missionary obedience from Pentecost, Luke makes it very special mention of the role of Holy Spirit in the mission of the Church. There is the proclamation. The spread of the gospel from the Jewish context to the Gentile world is also presented very clearly in the book of Acts. The preparation of Peter by the Holy Spirit for the interviews with Cornelius in chapter 10, or the ministry of Barnabas at Antioch. The sending of Paul and Barnabas on the first missionary journey, and even the Holy Spirit guides in different places, even in Jerusalem or in Macedonia or in Rome, justifying the mission to the Gentiles. Other references in Acts also show the action of the Holy Spirit in the spread of the gospel. Holy Spirit can associate equally with the function of the Father and Son. Matthew uses the singular name for the strengthening proof. Thus, the Church was born to say, while the outpouring of the Holy Spirit is experienced by the apostles. For it was only from that moment that the disciples saw, and they saw themselves as a community united to Father and to Christ through the Spirit. Therefore, Church is the creation of the Holy Spirit. We can say that the church was born on the day of Pentecost. The Holy Spirit can link believers to Christ and his church with Christ. And the next thing that we find is the role of Holy Spirit in the book of Acts. The first thing that we are dealing here is the coming of the Holy Spirit. Along with apostles, there were 120 people gathered with one accord on the day of Pentecost. At this very auspicious Jewish festival, 50 days after Passover, devout Jews gathered from every part of the world to Jerusalem. There, the Holy Spirit descended upon the disciples, enabling them that they had never known before such kind of power that they have experienced there in Jerusalem. Worshippers were astonished at this very strange experience that they have witnessed. These ordinary fishermen from Galilee, who had no proper education, were now able to speak to them in different dialects of the countries from which the worshippers have come. Others who had not understood Aramaic understood the message now in their own tongues, which the apostles had spoken. It was the great, amazing sign of the Holy Spirit among the people, those who were present there in Jerusalem. The second thing that we find is the speciality of the day of Pentecost. It is the inauguration of mission. The Greek word Pentecost means 50th. This feast used to be held every 50 days after the Feast of First Fruits. 50 days after the first fruit is the Feast of Pentecost, which pictures the formation of the church. The Jews celebrated Pentecost as the day of receiving the law. Jesus Christ rose as the first fruit of resurrection, and 50 days afterwards, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit was the beginning of the fulfillment of the prophet Joel's prophecy. The Acts community has a preparatory time, as in chapter 1 verse 8. The purpose for this preparation is to launch the world mission. When the power will be received, the members will be empowered to witness Christ Jesus locally, nationally, and internationally. Ultimately, it becomes the glocal in function. The word I use here to refer global and local mission. There is no discrimination, and all those who propose to launch the mission to witness and to speak and to experience a rapid development and formation of the new community. The next thing that we find here is a new experience on the day of Pentecost. There were three signs that accompanied the coming of the Holy Spirit. Number one, the sound of the wind that was like a rushing thunder. Number two, the tongues of fire. Number three, the believers were praising God in different languages. Glossolalia. The Holy Spirit came down with these three visible signs upon the 120 who were gathered in the upper room for receiving the power of the Holy Spirit from above as commanded by the risen Lord. The word Spirit is same. The meaning wind in Hebrew or Greek language. The people did not feel the rushing wind, but they heard the sound of a mighty wind. The tongues of fire symbolize the powerful witness of the church to the people. The combined symbols anticipated the rapid expansion of the mission of the early church. Acts sketches the course of the gospel to the Gentile world and presents a broad apology for Paul's Gentile mission, with its claim that the Gentiles can participate as Gentiles in God's salvation. In short, Gentiles do not need to become a Jew first. People were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in different tongues, which were unknown to them. It amazed the people from different languages that had gathered. Now here, surrounding nations are also witnessing it. At the building of Babel, the language of the people were confused and confounded as the consequence that they were scattered all over the face of the earth. Now, the day of Pentecost was launching the mission internationally to the international gathering, including Jews, proselytes, citizens of the Mediterranean world, and the representatives of diaspora, speak Aramaic, Greek, Hebrew, and some were bilingual. Now, they were united together in one accord. The event proclaims the inauguration of the contextual mission, and the response of the crowd exemplifies it. And the outcome of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, number one, Holy Spirit empowers. The Holy Spirit empowers the followers of Jesus Christ to witness Him as promised. The experience of the phenomena of Pentecost must be interpreted missiologically. The book of Acts recorded that when the Spirit rested upon the believers, the disciples, on the day of Pentecost, they spoke in other tongues, and that's a place for the beginning of ministry. They were empowered. The Holy Spirit enabled Peter to preach and penetrate the word of God into the hearts of the people through the power of the Holy Spirit. His message came powerfully that 3,000 people converted and added to the church because it was the convincing power of God. It led to baptism, which was an act of incorporation. The apostles and the disciples of Jesus have undertook the monumental task which were preparing others to become the followers of Jesus Christ. So to say, they became the disciples of Jesus to make the other disciples of Jesus. Making disciples to make disciples. People were convicted by the Holy Spirit, and they were being added to the church daily by the Lord. Now, the Holy Spirit in mission. It is not an overstatement to say the intimate linking of pneumatology and mission is Luke's distinctive contribution to the early church's missionary paradigm. The story of Peter's encounter with Cornelius, especially significant in the light which throws into the sovereign work of the Spirit in mission. Mission changes not only the world, but also the church. Mission is not just the expansion of church. It is something more costly and more revolutionary. It is the action of the Holy Spirit, who is sovereign and sovereign to give the freedom and to convict the world and lead the church towards the fullness of its truth, which has not yet grasped fully. Mission is not essentially an action by which the church puts forth its own power and wisdom to conquer the world around it. It is rather an action of God, putting forth the power of the Holy Spirit to bring the universal work of Jesus Christ for salvation of the world nearer to its completion. Mission is a risky endeavor. Its outcome is unpredictable. The Cornelius story shows that it is not easy for God to teach the church that he does not practice partiality. To many of us, the signs are strong that he has many ways of working in the world. And the next thing that we find is Spirit of God and the formation of the new community. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit took place in the community after the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Spirit of God came down upon the people on the day of Pentecost through Peter's message, and about 5,000 members were added to the church. Glossolalia was the subsequent phenomenon on the day of Pentecost, and the church began there, and the great power of the Holy Spirit functioned there. Peter was prepared by the Holy Spirit by giving him special vision to lead the people into the church. The Holy Spirit had played a dynamic role in the matter of conversion. People were convicted by the Holy Spirit and they were being added to the church daily. The house churches were the places of fellowship for mission and outreach centers. It dismantled the social barriers through table fellowship. The table fellowship was the universal symbol of friendship, and there is no bond or free, male or female, no Jew or Gentile, all were together. They were sharing and caring. Breaking the bread given an eschatological hope into eternity. The table fellowship was characterized by acceptance, anti-egalitarian society, rejecting the social classification, and so moving towards the holistic mission of the church. There is an universal scope of salvation, the universality of the mission. In the gospel, the ministry of Jesus unfolds three stages. One in Galilee, and his journey from Galilee to Jerusalem, and the final events in Jerusalem. Thus, the life of Jesus from Galilee to Jerusalem completes the task of mission locally. But Acts, the mission likewise evolves in three phases. One, it says, it begins from Jerusalem till the end of the earth. As it says in 1:8, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. The other follows. This is an outline for the whole book. Chapters 1 to 7 describe the spread of the gospel in Jerusalem. Chapters 8 and 9 describes its spread in Judea and Samaria. And the rest of the book is about the Christian mission to the whole world. It includes with Paul's arrival in Rome. However, this geographical outline is interrupted by a theological motif. Even if the gospel has only one explicit reference to Gentile mission, namely the mission commanded in Luke chapter 24 verse 47, the universal scope of salvation is underlined from the very beginning. The first two chapters points to Jesus as a savior, not only for the Jews, but also to the Gentiles. Luke characterizes the light of the world, which is Jesus, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for the glory of God to the people of Israel, which includes both Gentiles as well as Jews into the salvific plan of God. The power of the Holy Spirit is involved in healing ministry through the apostles. Thus, the Holy Spirit continued his mighty works through the disciples on whom he had poured out the Holy Spirit at the day of Pentecost to manifest God's mighty acts through the power of the Holy Ghost. And when we look at the character, Stephen was selected to the ministry at the table in Jerusalem church. He was one of the seven who were filled with the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 6 and 7 had recorded the longest single speech in the book of Acts as well as the turning point of Israel in their spiritual history. It records the nation's third important murder. The first one, John the Baptist, then Jesus Christ. Now, Stephen is the focus. The people are warned of their final rejection of the message of salvation. In his address, Stephen reviewed the history of Israel and pointed out that the nation that always rejected God's chosen leaders as they were first appeared, received in the second time. Death of Stephen took the message out of Jerusalem to the Samaritans and to Judea and even to the Gentile world. The conversion of Cornelius has vital importance in the opening of mission to the Gentile world. The Jews considered the Gentiles inferior to them and avoided all kinds of associations with them. This is what Peter had said in the house of Cornelius. You are aware that it is unlawful for a Jew to associate with or visit a Gentile. Once the universal nature of salvation in Christ Jesus is established in the Cornelius story, the mission spreads rapidly to the Gentile world. Therefore, by appealing to the conversion of Cornelius and his household, Peter recalls that they received Holy Spirit as they did the disciples in Jerusalem at the day of Pentecost. The Holy Spirit empowered the disciples and believers to proclaim the word of God to the unbelievers. Philip went down to a city in Samaria and proclaimed the good news about Jesus Christ over there. When the crowd heard Philip and saw the miraculous sign he did, they all paid close attention to what he said. And the shift that is taking place here from the first part of the story in Book of Acts, now the conversion and life of Paul. Paul was a native of Tarsus, a city of Cilicia, recorded in Acts 21:39, and was a pure Jewish descent of the tribe of Benjamin, says in Philippians chapter 3 verse 5. He was a Pharisee and his family had the Roman citizenship, and so Paul inherited the right of Roman citizenship from them. The apostles were afraid of Paul, and it was Barnabas who introduced Paul to the other disciples in Jerusalem. The fact that Paul was a stranger and even an enemy to the apostles is important. It proves that he got the message of salvation, message of grace from Jesus himself and not from any man. Paul stayed some days with Peter, almost 15 days, but he did not see any other disciples, nor he asked for permission from any of them. He did visit James, the Lord's brother. Paul wanted to minister to the Jews in Jerusalem, but God commanded him to depart from the city because God had a different plan for Paul. God's kingdom program had a ministry to fulfill among the Gentiles by Paul. Through the conversion of Paul, the church throughout Judea, Galilee, Samaria enjoyed a time of peace. It was strengthened and encouraged by the Holy Spirit. He grew in number, living in the fear of the Lord. First, Paul was convicted that he had seen the risen Lord. Second, Paul's life was rapidly and radically changed from the very day that he met Jesus towards even the ministry. There were some changes occurred in the life of Paul after his encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. The change was first indicated by Paul's response to the heavenly voice, "What shall I do, O Lord?" The second change was evidenced by the message Paul began to preach in the synagogue of Damascus. He is the Son of God. Now he has assumed the task of proving that Jesus is the Christ. Thirdly, there was a change in his sense of mission. He was convinced that God had called him to preach about Jesus, God's son, among the Gentiles. And so Paul was the missionary to the Gentile world. He was an apostle to the Gentiles. And we all know about Paul's missionary journeys. The missionary journeys of Paul are meant to reach the Gentiles with the gospel of Jesus Christ. He was commissioned by the Holy Spirit. Generally, the word pagan can mean heathen or a person outside the fold of people of Israel. So in order to reach them, the book of Acts records the world gospel tours of Apostle Paul. So in order to reach the world, book of Acts records the evangelistic tour of Paul to the Gentile world. The first missionary journey of Paul. In Acts 13 and 14, one can see Paul's first missionary journey. Some scholars believe that Paul and his companions departed for the missionary journey between 45 to 50 AD. However, still some others say it is probably between 47 to 48. Holy Spirit separated Paul and Barnabas for his ministry, and they brought John Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, with them. They sailed to Cyprus, the native place of Barnabas. The Roman government heard the arrival of Paul and Barnabas, had much curiosity to hear from them the word of God. But Bar Jesus, who was a false prophet and sorcerer, tried to turn the attention of the governor from them and the faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. But Paul rebuked him and he became a blind man. Then they went to Antioch and preached in the synagogues. Many of the Jews believed, but Pharisees turned the Gentiles and rose against him. But they went to three more Galatian cities and ministered the gospel. And in Lystra, because of a miracle, people came and worshipped them. But Paul and Barnabas said that they were just human beings. In Derbe, many became the disciples of Jesus. Then Paul and Barnabas started to revisit all the places and strengthen the believers and appointed elders in the local congregations. And we have the second missionary journey of Paul recorded from chapter 15, verse 36 to chapter 18, verse 22. When Paul and Barnabas planned for the second tour, visiting the churches, preaching the gospel, teaching the congregations, both had some divisions among themselves. Barnabas took John Mark, while Paul took Silas, and Timothy joined when they arrived to preach the gospel in the churches of the islands of Asia Minor. While Paul was in Tarsus, he got a vision that he saw a man of Macedonia who besought him, saying, "Come over into Macedonia and help us." This Macedonian call makes evident about the missionary work of Paul and the ministry of Paul in the city as well as the neighboring places, as Paul responded by going into the city. Then they came to Philippi, which is the chief city of the Mediterranean world. And it is also a Roman colony. They stayed there for certain days, and on a Sabbath, they went out of the city by the riverside where they had the prayer. There was a lady named Lydia. She was converted by the message of Paul. And yet another slave who brought gain to a master by her power of prediction. However, owing to some accusation, both Paul and Silas were beaten and imprisoned because they casted out the demon in that woman. In prison, they had a miracle. The chain of Paul and Silas were released. By seeing this, the jailer began to commit suicide. But Paul stopped it and shared God's word, and he believed in Jesus. Later they came to Thessalonica. There in synagogue they preached 3 days, and as a result, some Jews believed and some others tried to kill Paul. But knowing the situation of being zealous on the work of Paul and Silas as critical, they immediately sent Paul and Silas away from the house of Jason. Then they came at Berea, where apostles found the Jews as nobler than those of the Thessalonians. They gained many Jews and Greek converts. But due to the problem of Jews, Paul moved from there to Athens, continued his preachings there. Timothy and Silas also followed him. Paul preached in Athens, the city which was filled with idolatry. For the doctrinal discussion of the Epicureans and Stoics invited Paul to preach at Areopagus. And Paul reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and Greeks. Silas and Timothy joined him later. After a long stay at Corinth, Paul departed into Syria, taking with him Aquila and Priscilla. Then they came to Ephesus and landed at Caesarea and went down to Antioch. Thus Paul completed his second missionary journey. And the third missionary journey of Paul. Paul stayed as a short period at Antioch, and then he went for his third missionary journey, visiting Ephesus, Troas, Macedonia, Corinth, and the important places. In his journey, it is considered that he wrote his 11 letters. He ministered in Corinth for 3 years. The next 2 years, Paul did his teaching in public lecture hall. And because of the problems there, Paul moved from there to Troas. There, he got success. Paul reached and preached in Philippi, and then he also went to Corinth and stayed there for 3 months. Then Paul traveled to Jerusalem with Luke. Several events took place at this travel. The last travel recorded in Acts of Apostles is the journey to Rome. During the trial before Agrippa and Festus, Paul appealed to Caesar in Rome. After this, Agrippa sent Paul to Rome. His voyage to Rome is narrated in the first person plural, suggesting that Luke traveled with Paul on this trip. Probably Timothy embarked as well, and there may have been others also attending the apostle in his travel to Rome. Leaving Caesarea, moving through the island of Malta, he reached at the end the capital city of the Roman Empire, Rome. It was one of his ambitions to visit the capital of the empire. But there, he was not traveling as an evangelist, but as Caesar's prisoner awaiting the trial. He was guarded with a soldier, kept under a house arrest. Yet, he was free to receive the visitors by whom he could send some letters to the churches which are known as prison epistles. Though he was a prisoner there in Rome, yet he could preach the good news to the people even in the prison. Paul, as a missionary, deeply committed in his task, in his mission. Paul was called as an apostle to the Gentile world. He was set apart for the mission to the Gentiles. Primarily, Paul's commission was to be the apostle to the Gentiles, and would bring him before the kings. But he would also preach to his kinsmen according to the flesh, but experienced persecution from them. Paul's commitment towards Christ is for him to live is Christ and to die is gain. His mission is totally Christ-centered. There is some significance of the message of Acts for the present day. Primarily, it begins with the consequence of Pentecost. The Holy Spirit empowers to witness and perform miracles. Spirit leads and guides in mission to accomplish the task of the Great Commission. Though the growing church had to face persecutions, but these persecutions helped the church to not to limit to the Jewish territories, but to expand the mission to the Gentile world. The mission reached to the scattered people, of Israel in different places, and the Spirit of God guided them throughout. One important task fulfilled in Acts of Apostle is the mission through the house churches. The house churches were the places of fellowship and for mission outreach centers. Same as now in COVID-19, we have the same kind of situation, the house churches, sometimes single family churches. The house churches in Acts dismantle the social barriers through the table fellowship. The table fellowship was the universal symbol of friendship, and therefore it united the people together as in one accord. The house churches were the places of fellowship and mission outreach centers. These houses served as churches as well as the basement for apostles' mission work. The house of Lydia, Justus, etc. are the examples. They have played important role in the establishment of the local churches in their regions. In times of oppositions and persecutions, Jews would not allow the apostles to use their synagogues. So in order to continue the fellowship and instruction to the new believers, the apostles used house churches to serve this purpose. They also developed mission centers. Antioch virtually superseded Jerusalem as the home of Christian preaching and as the headquarters of the evangelistic missions. Paul and Barnabas had a hard time during the mission trip in Cyprus, but through the leading and guidance of the Holy Spirit, their mission and evangelism had become a great success. So the same in Pisidia, Iconium, Derbe, or Lystra. Acts of Apostle is also giving us the picture of a holistic mission. Restoration of the physical health, emotional and psychological restoration through the table fellowship, preaching, proclaiming and carrying out mission from Jerusalem to the end of the earth. There is care and compassion given to the needy. Caring for widows in chapter 6 is the beginning of the Christian ministry of the early church. There is also flexibility in mission work. The plan of gospelization and its mission belong to God. Therefore, Paul, in spite of having his own strategies for evangelism, he obeyed the call of God, which even had to conflicted with his own programs. The Spirit of God led him to new initiatives, new beginning. Human plannings and programs sometimes may not work out. Paul had to change his plans. The final goal of any is to bring the people into the saving knowledge of Lord Jesus Christ. Strategies are human. Apostle Paul had adopted the nature of flexibility in his gospelization. And ultimately, it is the mission from the context to the global, contextual to cross-cultural mission. From the Jewish Hellenistic milieu in Jerusalem and its environment to diaspora and to the global reach of the gospel is spread. Mission in the early church, it is God's mission for salvation. As the apostles reflected on the Savior, God sent His Son, He highlighted the motive, context, task, and result of his mission. The apostles were also very much aware of God's sending of the Spirit in the last days. Spirit comes to empower the witness of the gospel and to be a salvation blessing, bearing witness to the intimate union of believers with the Lord Jesus Christ and ultimately the Father. He is the means by which the Godhead is omniscient and omnipresent in the present world. The work of these messengers comes into nothing if the word, the message of salvation, is not sent and heeded. Salvation sent to those who will listen, and it must go to Israel and also to the Gentiles. So intent is the Godhead that the mission go forward. So essential is the human messenger that through a vision, spiritually needy Gentiles are sent to summon a Jewish Christian apostle to preach to them under their roof. They proclaim the message of the gospel and Jesus, the divinely sent one. The book of Acts tells us the story of Jesus continuing his mission from heaven through the church. It is about God having people from every nation, language, and every culture brought back into the right relationship with himself. Jesus left heaven and came to this earth to fulfill his mission by living perfectly, dying sacrificially, and rising victoriously. The book of Acts continues the story of God's mission through his church. The 28 chapters of Acts chronicle the early church going from relatively small, unimpressive group of disciples to an explosive global religion that turned the world upside down. And all of this happened in about 30 years of time, but its effect still continues because the same Spirit is working throughout the ages now until the return of Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. K.B. Jayasri ma'am. Your presentation was excellent, creatively brilliant, and profoundly fantastic indeed. I'm sure everyone in this webinar will agree with me that you are a genius. Thank you for introducing God is the God of mission. Thank you for exploring Latin roots of mission. Thank you so much indeed for unpacking a number of crucial milestones and issues related with Pentecost and the mission of the early church. God's activity to reach out to the cross-cultural, geographical boundaries, continuation of Christ's mission. It is really fascinating to see the role of the Holy Spirit in the mission of the church, preparation of the Peter, in different geographical locations such as Jerusalem, Rome, Macedonia, and different parts of the world. Thank you for exploring the speciality of the day of Pentecost, the inauguration of mission, witnessing Jesus Christ locally, nationally, globally, together called as glocally. Thank you for exploring three signs of new experiences: the sound of wind, the tongues of fire, the believers praising God in different languages, how Holy Spirit empowers evangelically, missiologically. Thank you for exploring mission as costly thing, something revolutionary, something risky. It is really amazing to see the journeys of Paul, how God had a different plan in the life of Paul, how Paul's life rapidly, radically changed, how Paul was a missionary to the Gentile world. Thank you so much for connecting the challenges in today context, how house churches are administered during COVID-19 as a sign of table fellowship. I'm sure all of us enjoyed this creative presentation. I give this time to the audience. Please raise your questions. Before you raise your questions should focus on the topic. Your questions should be precise. Your questions should be inclusive. Over to the audience. You can click, those who want to raise your question, you raise your hand, or you can click the reactions button here. I'm showing here like this, so that we can call your name.
Are you able to hear me, sir?
Yes, please, sir. Mr. Jeevan Sirigiri. Yes, please, sir. Over to you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Yes, yes. I appreciate the WhatsApp group created to listen to ma'am again. But only, sir, can you able to nutshell of the three missionary journey of Paul? And accompanying the disciples also will be more elaborated if you explain a little bit of the where he stayed 3 months, and throughout the missionary journey. But who accompanied and what made the reason that they could not able to join for the second and third missionary journey? It will be more appropriate. You got me, sir? No.
Yes. Dr. Jayasri, ma'am, would you kindly respond, please?
Thank you, Jeevan. Hope I'm communicating. It's clear. Thank you, Jeevan, sir, for stream that is raised. Making something in nature, it's good. We read that reading is recorded in Acts of Apostles. For me, you have asked about the travels of the apostles, the partners in mission. It's, as of me, the mission on wheels. Mission on wheels. It was not just static. It was in one place. All of them moved from the place where they were. I think that's a speciality of Acts of Apostles. Either we see or look at the disciples gathered in Jerusalem or any places. They joined for sure, but they also moved from the place from where they were. And when we see these disciples moving from place to place, we know we do not have travels of our apostles. Luckily, we have travels of Paul. And we know the reason, because probably Luke was the co-traveler. And to say the reasons why we don't have the records of, though we know it, that is Acts of Apostles. But just few chapters that we have, that also, just two or three apostles' life and their preaching total recorded. Then we have only the Acts of Paul. And sometimes we feel reading Acts of Apostles, reading the travel report. And if we let the sections, either we can narrate in just two or three place names, locations, because say when we look at the strategies of mission by Paul, we say that he has concentrated in cities. And the cities that you know commonly, that from Antioch anyway, then Corinth, the most important significant place, and Philippi is at a place, and other place, even which he might have begun to adjust because there is no letters written to them, or because, the situation, politics of then or now, we do not have detailed records of those things. And for me, just as I said, it's mission of wheel, and therefore, we cannot explain detailly of all those who have joined, who have not joined, one. Secondly, when we see people, those who joined with either the division between Paul and Barnabas, or Timothy joined with them, these are personal, very personal. Because even on Mark seems unpleasant to travel with Paul in one stage of the travel, but later we find he joins. So it's truly personal. I think I answered you.
Thank you, ma'am. There is a question by Samuel Sunit. I'm reading here from the chat box. What are the advantages and disadvantages of house churches then? How can you compare at the present situation of COVID-19?
Thank you so much for the question. Glad that we started house churches again. We know the church began as house churches only. Even if it is 120 or 150 gathered in the early church, though we title it as church, it was not church. We know that didn't gather in Jerusalem till. When we refer to Jerusalem church, it is not Jerusalem temple. And when we say Jerusalem church, we do not have a location to say or a house to say this is the Jerusalem church. Because these disciples, they gathered in the upper room, just a house. And then from then on, we talk about the earliest churches, all of them. Warehouses. When we detail study Corinthian correspondence, know it. The places where Paul fought in other places, other writings, especially the city of Corinth, many scholars agree that it is one church in Corinth had all problems inside it. But different churches in Corinth, different locations in Corinth, same as this that talk about early church. So, it was the house churches that we are referring as the earliest churches. Now, in our context, maybe because of COVID-19, we started thinking about house churches. But I have seen even some years ago in Bangalore and other places, the networking fellowship of the churches were concentrating on house churches. The local congregations beat so much of prejudice that sometimes a lot of people did not enter into it because of doctrinal issues to some extent, but in practically. In the church, particular location has prevented the people from joining the church. The testimony of Christ is at another thing. But other side, for me, beginning the house churches is not just because of COVID-19, it is already working out in the cities where two or three families could come together and then have the fellowships. And in situations as this, for us, that we have single family churches. To some extent, the single family churches can never replace the house churches or the churches, the physical churches that we had till March. Why I think this way? Because we know we have it in the house churches or in the congregation which joined till last year. Most importantly, we talk about vertical and horizontal relationship. Now we have a social distance, even with the family. So if we look at house churches and single family churches that we have today, we cannot bear it. Because we don't have a kind of fellowship that we supposed to share as Christian fellowship within these gatherings, number one. Second, the outcome of this gathering or house churches, the table fellowship, as I said earlier, dismantling every barrier, either social or religious traditions that held thus far, or gender discrimination. That is not in the house churches, whereas now in COVID-19 single family churches, we cannot have table fellowship or Lord table. And we know recently there is some critical situations and comments made over some kind of over exaggerated presented Lord Supper at home. So for us, it's a challenge that if we are able to gather our house churches, I think many advantages that we have, because a close attachment would be seen within the house churches than in the congregational gathers of our churches, number one. Number two, when we have it as house churches, everyone's need is met instantly. But in the congregational gatherings that we had, sometimes we ignore some categories, including children. But just in the house churches, we have respect for men and children because we host it or we serve. And therefore, there is recognition than in the congregational church and many more, because there are other questions. I just stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. There is a question from Jonah Cherla. What is the significance of the events of Tower of Babel and the Day of Pentecost?
I called it Tower of Babel because that was the place, still then they had one language. And that was the place where the language is capturing the people. Just divine enter in the Tower of Babel. Whereas, always speaking language, but communicating each other in the Day of Pentecost, in the glossolalia. Unity, but even with languages. Any language, people from every language, every tribe, any place and person can come in this place. And they're there, and they were to communicate with. That is why they were surprised. They were surprised that they were hearing the languages were known to them. And now it is communicating. Tower of Babel, miscommunication or excommunication. Now here, communication, joining people together to stand one. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. The next question is from Matsung Longkumar. Pentecost event is filled with the speaking in tongue. Today, many churches emphasize on speaking of tongue. What is the difference between the Pentecost event and today's church emphasizing on speaking on tongue?
Thank you so much for the question. First, in two ways that we interpret it. One, the Day of Pentecost, the time in which all of them spoke in different tongues. And it was messaged to everybody. They said, you know the reason why they gathered together. When they heard the sound of people speaking in tongues, all who were there, either speaking in Aramaic, Greek, or any language, they gathered together to listen to these people, what they're speaking. And what they speak, that is not recorded. What was the message that communicated is not recorded. But now, we are sure that in the congregations in which that we speak about speaking in tongues, which is completely different from what we see in Acts of Apostles. That first, I think we need to form a position of 1 Corinthians chapters 12 and 14, where we find it a gift of the Holy Spirit given church. One of the gifts is recorded speaking in tongues. And this being in tongues, not necessarily find just in Acts of Apostles. There are places that we find people speaking and some are understand what is spoken. In some places, we even globally, we enter in two ways, one, speaking in other tongues or unknown tongues. And in the church, normally present, but insisting about speaking in tongues, we talk about unknown tongues, not other tongues. And those who don't even follow speaking in tongues, speaking in unknown tongues, they do end with speaking in other tongues, which they say, or which we say, that you learn a language, it is because of the Holy Spirit that is permitted us, same as William Carey, learning more than 40 languages, humanly impossible, but the Spirit of God enabling one to speak another thing, at other tongues or languages. Thank you.
Ma'am, this will be the last question from Lal Ring Pachuau. I'm reading his question. Is there any sign or work of the Spirit which was found in the apostolic churches that are no more necessary or inappropriate for today?
Thank you so much, Augustine. Interesting. Because Christian churches divided and major on this particular doctrine issue between one particular tradition and with other traditions. Giving importance to the Holy Spirit and the sign of the Holy Spirit. There is no place in the New Testament that is recorded at any stage. The work or the signs of Holy Spirit cease to exist. I repeat, there is no place in the New Testament or record of the New Testament documents. In no place it is recorded the signs or the work of the Holy Spirit cease to exist, or it has completed its task mission on earth. We understand it is given to the church till the Lord's return. It will continue its work, and the signs will continue till his return. Thank you.
Before I give this time to Professor Dr. Johnson Thomas Kuti, the architect and a brilliant mind behind this webinars, I sincerely thank Dr. Jayasri ma'am for your fantastic and profound presentation. As a sign of respect and thanks, shall we all raise our hands and wave, saying, thank you so much, ma'am. You won our hearts. We'll continue to ponder on your reflections. Thank you so much indeed. I give this time to Professor Dr. Johnson Thomas Kutisa. Over to you, sir.
7 minutes. I express heartfelt thanks once again to such a program. And for all those who participated, all those who asked the questions, I appreciate it deeply. And it's my pleasure, great privilege that the Lord has given me. And I thank John, sir, for giving me the opportunity and for all the work behind. Especially I thank my moderator for lavishly using sound of words to me. Thank you so much, and I appreciate all of you. Thank you for your friends, patience listening to me, and thank you CCI and CS. Thank you so much.
So thank you, Dr. Jayasri, for this wonderful and marvelous presentation. There are many people behind the scene. The most significant person is Father Dr. Matthew Chandran Gundayan, the director of ECC. And Mr. Minlun, who is a deputy director of ECC, and Reverend Sugumar, who is the program coordinator of ECC, and all these significant people, as well as CSI Church and its various dioceses, are giving leadership for this wonderful program. Because of that, we all are privileged to come together and glorify God's name. And we have heard about the Pentecost and the mission of the church in the book of Acts. And in between, somebody raised a question, the Gospel of John chapter 20, verse 22, where Jesus says, Jesus breathes on the disciples and telling them, receive the Holy Spirit. That event is called the Johannine Pentecost. And it's like a Lucan interpretation of Pentecost and the Johannine interpretation of Pentecost are two different enterprises, and John places it before, and Luke places it toward the end of Jesus' mission in the world. But some people say that this is a matter of chronological misplacing, okay? And various other theoretical aspects are going on in relation to, okay, how to look at the anachronistic aspects related to the Pentecost placed in the Gospel of John and in the Book of Acts. These are two different interpretations. Okay, that is another argument. So we are very much privileged to have Dr. Jayasree for giving us this marvelous presentation. And what I have seen is that she was traveling all through, okay, the 28 chapters within 45 minutes. Okay, that is a great achievement. And she already covered the entire book. Okay, usually we study, okay, a book over a year. Is that one lecture she gave a nutshell of the entire book from the mission point of view. So that is very significant. And the same way we are going to continue in the next week, we are going to have Dr. Bennett Aaron Lawrence, and he is the Assistant Director of the Asia Theological Association, a New Testament scholar. And he is going to present, give the next lecture on Paul's message to the Romans and the Galatians together. Paul's message to the Romans and to the Galatians. So please be present. The assignment for next week is write in 300 words about the day of Pentecost and the mission of the early book of Acts, with implications in the contemporary context. Okay, once again, write in 300 words about the day of Pentecost and the mission of the early church in the book of Acts, with implications to the contemporary context. So thank you so much.
Mr. Kumar.